to upload the PowerPoint.
Enable screen capture preview in the bottom left.
Yeah, enable here. Here. Yeah. Here, thank you. So that is, the two type of the, saving name. And also, we're using Flores dyes to distinguish the two samples of saving, basically label the two mRNA. Okay? We're using the red color and the green color. Okay? Usually, we're using the red color to label treatment sample. And we're using green color to label control color. Okay, here, the control is a normal cell, and the treatment is sample is cancer cells. Okay? The fluorescence of the dye is called Psi-3, Psi-3, and Psi-5. That is a biological fluorescence dyes. That's a Psi-3 and a Psi-5. So this is the green. These are red. Okay. And then those two DNA saving samples, labeled saving samples, are mixed together, put together. So at this stage, they're separately done. And at this stage, they combine together, or mix together. And then, hybridize this labeled molecule population onto a microwave. The microarray chip. Okay. So on this chip, there are so many spots, or we call the fluorophore. This fluorophore density that are made on the microarray chip. There are so many. Tens of thousands of those are labeled on this or built on this chip. So basically the chip is a holder of those fluorophore. Okay? Each of them are used for particular gene, in other words, one gene in the genome. So those are defined. How do they make this? They are designed according to the genome information. For example, here, if those are cells comes from the human, so those microarrays are particularly for human. So they made the different microarrays for different species: human, mouse, arabidopsis, yeast, barley, rice, whatever. Okay, so in other words, those fluorophore are designed according to sequencing information of the species the array represent. So here is where the genome sequencing pattern is used. Okay, basically we have the lot of the genome sequencing pattern. So here, how to design the different arrays for different species? That's entirely based on the sequencing information. For example, here is a human. If this array is a human array, okay, how many genes in the human? Basically, 20-something. Yes, that's correct. 20-something thousand, 20 to 30,000 of annotated genes. So in other words, we know that 20-something thousand genes, each of the genes is presented by several of these chlorophyll for each of these spots. Okay? So there are tens of thousands of this spot densely distributed on the array. Can you imagine the same scenario? Each of the spot belongs to one particular gene. The question is how to specifically design this spot. We call them probes. Okay? This probe all corresponding to each of these fluorophore several of these fluorophores standing for one gene, represented one gene on the array. Or in other words, each of the genes annotated in a particular genome paired to human is presented by several of these probes. Some of tens, some of even hundreds of these. That depends on the length of the gene, depends on the sequence, uniqueness of the gene. So, what you imagine is this array represents the whole genome of the expressed gene. So in other words, every expressed sequence in the genome must be presented on this array. Okay? And then, after the hybridized this stuff, this mixed, labeled, fluorescent and labeled cDNA to the array, and then the next step is washing. Washing away those non-specific binding between the probe and the transcription molecule or the cDNA molecule. You can imagine how the expression of the gene a more abundant of the transcript of the gene. So in other words, have the chance, it must have the better chance to hybridize on its own probes. Okay? And those which are not perfectly matched or very badly matched between transcript and the probe will be washed away at this step. Only those which is have the better correspondence between the probe and then the transcript molecule will be keep on the array. After the washing step, we're using kind of the machine, that is what we call the library automatic machine, to scan that this array. And then it turns out like this. You can say each of the spots, that is just part of this array. You can show the lot of spots. Some of the spots is a light off, some of the spots still dark. Those light off means the probe, okay, have get the higher hybridization of the transcript. In other words, that indicates, gives the information about whether or not the genes are expressed, or whether or not the whole gene are expressed. the dark ones, that means there is no, you cannot find out any of the corresponding transcripts for that particular gene, so it's still keeping dark. Those are lighted up, that means the transcript of some particular genes are there, and then captured by the plots. Okay? So first of all, this shows which gene is expressed, which gene is not expressed. And also this slide provided information that about the relative intensity of the light. The lighter one means the higher level of expression. Okay? Some of the much lighter than others. So for example, this one is not as light as this one. That means the gene for that probes expressed higher, the more RNA transcripted at that gene. We know that is the third, that is the second part. First of all, I can give the information about whether one particular gene is expressed or not expressed, reflected by whether the corresponding port is light off or not light off. Okay? The second part is the degree of the light. How strong the light gives the indication what are the degrees of the gene expression. Lighter, the higher expression. The darker, the lower expression. And thirdly, you can say some colors look green, some colors look red, some color looks like the orange. Why? That color reflects the two colors. If the light, if the red, that means this is dominant. If the red means that is dominant. If something like this is, means this is dominant. So that is gives the idea about a relative expression of particular gene between the two samples. So that is where we said this technique is very useful for comparing gene expression between the two samples. Okay? And yes, of course, some of them, for example, is orange, is yellow, or lighter yellow. That means probably these two genes express the more or less the same level between the two samples. I got an idea what is a microarray, what is a microarray really. That is my language, it's very, very simple. Yes, of course, the technique behind this principle is much more sophisticated. You can find out the same this is what we call basically the Agilent technique. You can find out if you want to know more about the technical aspect, you can browse that from the website. So we take a 10-minute break and then we come back. And also before, during the time, this is the university requirement that needed to attend this report.
question. Can I ask you whether different tissues or organ express different genes with different intensity of fluorescence gene chip?
Yeah.
Because if we want to compare cancer sample from our lung,
mm-hmm.
We need to make specific microarray gene chip.
No, not a specific microarray for that organ. It's a specific array for human. And because of the gene, no matter which organ, you know, they don't have the same, all the cells contain the same set of gene, right?
But different tissues and organs express different genes.
Yes, of course. Yes. It doesn't make express the genes will be different from the different organs. Yes. But the same of lung, you know, is the same organ. Same tissue, so they should be, basically they should be identical. The only the expression, because there are so many, the expression is subjected to so many biological issues. Okay, so anyway, so what is your question, Okay, you can think about that. That is what we said is for this to teach you. Okay, can we stop now? And basically, you can say, yes, I interpreted that, I explained what this microarray, what this color means. Okay. And then the scanner can collect. So in other words, the lightness of this spot reflected the hybridization density. Okay, hybridization intensity reflects the level of the expression of the transcript. Okay, so in other words, this different color, the lightness and the different colors of, we can collect it using the scanner, reflect the level of gene expression and also relative expression of the gene between the tested samples and the normal samples. Okay, so that is so the scanner, basically the scanner can extract the hybridization intensity of the red color and the green color hybridization. That gives the direct information about the transcript expression, the abundance of the transcripts of the labels, the green labeled cDNA and the red labeled cDNA. Okay, this is how the cDNA microRNA data generated. Okay? So that is the, how can we do, this is the, you know, when I say what we collected from the microarray experiment, or hybridization intensity. Okay. The basic idea of microarray data analysis, or sitting in microarray data analysis here, is trying to extract the gene expression level or convert it, hybridization single into expression level. The major problem of this fluorescence intensity single are they vulnerable to both biological and non-biological variation. Biological means those genes express in various level, and the genes may express differently between the two samples. Those are biological parts. Which part will be when to collect it? Yes, of course, at the same time, you can say this procedure may incorporate a lot of variation, technically, manually. We put all this kind of source of information in one part called the non-biological ones. In other words, the hybridization intensity we collected must be subjected both biological and non-biological. The microdata analysis, the goal of microdata analysis is trying to remove the non-biological part from the array data. After this removal of the non-biological variation components, what the left is on the gene expression. So the data analysis of microRNA data analysis is as simple as that in idea. Okay? So, yes, of course, for different settings, you may be dealing with a single array, or you may also working with multiple arrays. Okay, so the data analysis may cover single array data analysis, and also multiple array data analysis. The principle are the same, but in detail they may have some difference. Okay, so that is what is the major problem of the sitting of microarray data, and what is our aim of the microarray data analysis. And before I go into detail about how this non-biological variation can be removed from the microarray data, we're first going to show us about what the microarray data Oh, sorry. What kind of the non-biological variation in microdata could be? Okay. We split this variation into two different kinds. The first is the weighting array. What was the non-biological variation? There are listed five different types of non-biological variations. Okay. First of all is the background signal. Background signal, background variation of an array, that which is a weighted individual. So in other words, the spot, the probe at a different size, weighting the array may differ due to the unevenness of the array chip, or because of the location issue of the probe. That may differ. Okay, thank you. And also, when I say two seeding samples are hybridized on a single array, yes, of course, we try to equalize the amount of two samples, but it's not possible to make the perfect equality of the two samples cDNA to be hybridized into the same array. So that causes the problem. That is the second source of the non-biological variation. And thirdly, as they say, the transcribed molecules or cDNA molecules scan on the same array randomly. So you cannot avoid what we call the cross hybridization. In other words, some of the transcript hybridized to the probe, which is not corresponding to the transcript sequence. You understand what I mean? What I call the cross hybridization or non-specified hybridization. Okay, for example, this is a prop. Prop is also the sequencing. And then some of the transcript. So this is for example, this is for gene A. This prop is for gene A. And then the transcript, this is a molecule transcript from gene B. Okay, by chance, this transcript molecule may also bound each other, bound to this force. So this kind of the bonding or hybridization is called a non-specific hybridization or called a cross-hybridization. Okay. Well, expect those perfectly bounding to that. The gene A's way expect the gene A's transcript perfectly hybridized to gene A's corresponding probe. But in reality, it's not, you cannot guarantee it's hybridized every time. There's still some of the some other genes transcript hybridized partially too. Yes, of course, we try to wash it that away as hard as possible. But you cannot avoid making this 100%. Okay, so that is the second part. And also the handling issues, for example, some experiment carried out in Birmingham, same example of saving a profile in Birmingham, profile in Shanghai or in Tokyo, then they probably have different things. That is a variation across the different experiments. And the people manipulated this experiment or instrument, they may cause some of this variation. Those are all problem of the hybridization issues. And the dye effect, for example, okay, so the two dyes, the red color and the green color, then have the different response to the laser excitation. Okay, so sensitivity are different. So all those are called weighing array. In other words, an individual array may subject to these five kinds of non-biological variation. Among them, the first four are called non-systematic. And the dye effect is called systematic because red color is more sensitive to laser excitation than the green color. So in other words, an average red color hybridization signal is higher than green color hybridization signal. So that is why we call them systematic. And also, we have the B2N, sometimes the experiment may require more than one array. The different arrays, they have the B2N arrays variation. So I listed here, for example, replicated variation is a the biological experiment come perfectly replicated. So that is the replication variation. And also, batch info the array, for example, the different arrays may produce at the different batches, different times or different factories, then may have the difference, inherently difference to the array data. And the handling, for example, the protocols or whatever, there's a different design of arrays. Some companies design, for example, the human, some companies design the antigen, some companies design the other companies. Okay, so they have this kind of the between array variation. So you need to build up this kind of the concept about what source of variation, because the focus of the lecture is on Zhenbu lung biological variation. So, to do so, before that, you know how to do it, you must know what kind of variation exists for the microwave. Okay? So what the data look like? So this is the original data. This is the data collected from the machine, what we call the scanner, microwave scanner. This is the data when you're on the experiment, you expected to collect the data like this type, this format from the scanner. Scanner will provide the microarray scanner machine will provide this kind of information. So I put this into 1, 2, 3, 4 blocks of the data. You just know what they are. Okay, if you have the closed loop, then you should have the better idea. Basically, this is a header description headline. That they give is what each color, what is the colors of this data from here to here, what is each of the color, what the data means, you know, precisely. And your attention, basically what we get from this or this three part of the data, these are really data. The first part is a log ratio of channel to normalized over channel one normalized data. Okay, so I will interpret to you in the later on what is the channel one or the channel. We know channel, we have two channel data, red color and the green color that respond to two channels. Okay, the two data are separated in here, these two blocks, these channel ones, the mean hybridization, mean and the standard deviation of channel one hybridization signal, and also median. Standard deviation of channel 1 background intensity. We say that the background effect, what is the average level of hybridization level? This is provided all these sort of things. This block is for channel 1, this block is for channel 2. Two channels reflect the red and the green color, the separate them. But usually you can spot in the different color, but precisely, the scanner provides exactly what you have as a signal for green channel and for red channel. Again, the two channels reflect the two hybridized, the two fluorescent colors, or two samples, okay, because they're labeled different color. Okay? So that is the data. Basically, what we really use of those data, or those, the data analysis we use, working with that, how to collecting this data, and then the following discussion will tell you how to process the data we collected from channel 1 and channel 2. So, from now on, I give you an example to show how non-biological variation, okay, to demonstrate what the biological, non-biological variation will look like. Okay. So, I give you a set of data. This data set is basically, this is the description of the data sets I will show you later on. The messenger RNA extracted from a budding yeast strain at the same stage. Okay? Yeast cells that are in the same development stage. Okay, that is the same strain. Genetically, they are same. Why are we using yeast? Because the yeast is easy to keep their genetic identity. They all say the shared common genetic background. Okay? So there is a population of cells. This is a particular type, it's a budding yeast. And then the RNA extracted from the yeast, this yeast cells population, this RNA was split into 6 replicates. So in other words, they are same RNA from the same yeast population, yeast cell population. Okay, so the same RNA, but now they are split into 6 parts. Okay, biologically they are same. Okay, and then this 6, each of these 6 again split into 2 parts. So in total we have 12. So messenger RNA split into 6 replicates. In one of the 6s, it is split again. One part is labeled with green, and another part labeled with red. Okay. In other words, this 6, this 12 should be the same, because they come from the same, like the same yeast strain. Okay. So basically, we're using the yeast sending a microarray yeast version 2. Saving a microarray. Okay, so why is it number version 2? Because this is the evolve due to the more information, more, you know. So that is a basic, anyway, that is a version 2, that is the type of the array. Okay, but this is the technique we use that. Okay? And then we're demonstrating these 12 channels of data. Okay, we carry out using these 12 RNA saving samples. We use the 12 saving samples to carry out the hybridization experiment. And then we can collect the 12 channels of data, right? Okay, got it? Any problem? We talk about the 12 channels. Because 6 replicates ship like it's filled and split into two, half of them labeled with green, half labeled with red. So we have 12. We're using, demonstrating the data set graphically. This gives you an idea about what the data look like. So we have 12 channels of data. 1, 2, 3, 4, 11, 12. So each of these, this we call the box plot. I listed that in your statistical terms and the basic plot. Does anybody know what is a box plot means? Can you explain one of the box plot for me? So that is the way, basically, box plot. What is a box plot for?
So you can show sort of the highest value, the top sort of standard deviation, median, bottom standard deviation, bottom value.
Yeah. It basically, box plot, yes, that's correct. And he gives the part of the correct answer about what the show. Basically, box plot is the graphical presentation of a large data set. Graphical presentation, illustration of large data or big data set. Box plot is a graphical presentation of a large data set. Yes, of course, this is graphical. It shows its central tendency and also it shows a range of variation. Tendency, that means where the data set's value centered, you know, that is what we call the central tendency and also the range of variation and you know. So I precisely what this is, what it is, how did they make this? Yes, of course this is, how did they make this, you know, box plot? First of all, no matter how many data sets, x1, x2, xn, okay, n is very large. N is very large, it means you have so many data. And then, they sorted the data into the ascending order or descending order. So for example, x1, x2, xn. From smallest to highest, okay? That is what they say, order. So this is comes from that, but it's ordered. The first datum is the smallest amount of original data, and the second smallest to the largest. Okay, the data with that observation in the middle, at the middle of this ordered sequence, is called the median, right in here. Okay, and those, then that one, that observation, Q1 is the observation which is cut off this sequence into two parts. The left hand, there are 20% of the data. So they call the 25% tail. Yes, of course, median, what is the median? Is the 50% tail, right? Because that is the middle, in order to split the whole data set into two parts, each side has 50%. So that we call it the median. And then, you know, 70%. And then they have the fence, this gives the idea what is called lower fence and upper fence of the data. Fence. Fences. Lower and upper fence. Fences. Okay, any values above these two fences are called outer layer. Okay. So for example, those data which beyond or below the fences are called the outer layers. So you can say this is a way. The data come from that is 5 times 15k, 8 times 15k data. There are so many of this data. It's about 120,000 data. So each of these box presented about 120,000 data. It's really, really a lot of data. But how you can say it's not easy to list them in the paper, but it's multi-liter if you put them into a graphical way. It shows you, for example, where are the data centralized. So this bit, this, in other words, there are 50% of data in this level. Okay? And then the range of that, the variation of the range of that, it shows this kind of, this is the range of the data. So, in other words, box plot shows the central tendency of the data and also variation of the data, graphically. Now, after we know what this means, and then now, this 12 channels of data, they connected, basically, they connected from the same samples, right? They should be identical. If there is no, basically there is no biological variation here, because they are the same. All those are reflected on biological. All those reflect this variation. You can show between, this is on the same slides, slide one, slide two, array one, array two. These two blocks, just because the two samples are labeled with a different color. And then those six pairs reflect the between array variation. Okay. So this shows you how abundant non-biological variation could be. Okay. I said if there were no non-biological variation, those bar blocks should look like more than the same. But this looks so different. The dependency is different. And then the variation is also different. Across different array and the weighting array between the different colors. I show that this gives you an idea what is the, you know, non-biological variation look like. That is the yes, of course, how to make this box plot. You know, it's very difficult manually, but it's very simple. if you're using R script. Okay, so that is the R script that we can make the, just get the data from scanner and then generate the box plot I show you in the Prevails slide. Okay, but R is that I will give you the tutorial about R, and also I will give you a tutorial on how to use R to run this program to demonstrate how the box plot will change. R is a kind of the statistical software for statistical analysis and for graphical presentation. So that is a very useful stuff. The R is the free software, and you can download that into. So what does this mean? This explains to here. I will not go into detail, just the computer language is just the kind of the grammar. Okay, you cannot, I have no intention to interpret why they should do this, because this is everybody. It's just like a language. Why do we say language in this way? That is, people agree with it. So basically, let's give you an idea, some of the idea. Logically, what we say, no matter how many data sets, roughly, we present the data into the matrix. I'll give you some idea how do they organize the data. Okay, we have the data X. So that means the data that is stored data set. Is a matrix. No matter how many rates, this is a general. The microdata analysis will always store the original hybridization data into a matrix. What is a matrix like? R-based microdata analysis always store the original data into a matrix. What they are, this is the hybridization. Signal. The signals comes from the scanner, okay? This is from channel 2. This is from the channel. Okay. And then this is a hybridization signal. From 1.